Hi everyone, and welcome to my talk about Trusted Platform Modules, or TPMs for short. My name is Jonas Witschel. Online I also go by the nick of Diabonos on sites like GitHub, Reddit, or on IRC. I have been actively involved with the Arch Linux project for about a year now as a trusted user, and I am also one of the maintainers of the TPM2 software project on GitHub, where I maintain TPM2 TOTP, which I'm going to show off today as well. So to get started with the actual talk, the first question I imagine some of you might have is, what actually is a trusted platform module and why should I care about it? Well, a trusted platform module is a small chip on your computer and it's totally separate from your main system. So it has its own memory and processing capabilities, and it can do cryptographic operations like encrypting stuff or signing stuff. And the idea is that you can store secrets on the TPM totally separate from your main system and do operations there, and you never expose them to your actual system. So why is this important? Well, an example many of you might be familiar with are SSH keys. So an SSH key is essentially a small secret you use to authenticate against servers on the internet. And usually these secrets are stored on disk. They might be protected by a password, but still, if an attacker manages to get a hold of your system, they can be able to, exfiltrate the file, sniff the password, and then they can do anything they like with your SSH keys. And the idea is with a TPM, you can store this secret in the TPM and then ask the TPM, okay, I need you to sign this data to authenticate against another server. Still, if an attacker gets into your system, they are able to talk to the TPM and do stuff with it, of course. But once you switch up off the computer, they can't do anything anymore with it. And if you suspect there's something wrong with your system, you can just wipe it, reinstall your operating system, and continue using your keys because they are always stored there and never exposed to your main system. The next question you might have is, okay, great, now do I actually own a TPM? Well, the good news is that many devices already come equipped with a TPM. Especially laptops, because I think it's some kind of the Microsoft certification requirement. And even if you don't have a separate chip, many modern processors do have one implemented in the firmware. So in this case, of course, the distinction between the TPM and the main system is a bit blurred, but still it's way better than just storing your secrets on disk. And unfortunately, there are two different incompatible versions of the TPM specification. There's TPM 1.2, which is old and deprecated by now because it uses obsolete cryptography like SHA-1. So you don't want to use this if you can. The new specification is TPM 2.0, where all cryptographic algorithms are flexible. So if one gets obsolete, you can just exchange it. Unfortunately, these two versions require totally different software stacks. So today we're only going to talk about TPM 2.0 devices. And to find out whether you have one of these, you can just look for the device file dev TPM RM0 on your system. So if you've got that, you know that you have a TPM 2.0 device that you can use. Even if you don't have one, there are software emulators available, so if you want to just to get started with the concepts, or even if you have a TPM, to play around with it without fear of losing important data or breaking your TPM somehow, you can use one of these. Please don't use them to store actual secrets because they just store everything on disk, so it's not more secure than just storing your SSH keys in a file as usual, but for playing around it's quite nice. So next question is probably, okay, I want to use the TPM, how do I do that? Well, fortunately, the TPM specification is open. You can just freely download it. There's also a standardized C API, and there are multiple open source implementations of this API. The one we are going to use today is called TPM2 TSS and related software. So you can just download that from GitHub and start coding. Of course, this is great if you want to create new programs, if you want to make existing programs aware of a TPM that might be a bit of work to get it into all software in existence. Fortunately, there are other existing standards to access cryptographic tokens like these USB smart cards you might have to store, for example, SSL certificates. One of these standards is called PKCS11, and there is some kind of bridge between this standard and the TPM, which is called TPM2 PKCS11. You can use this for all software that is PKCS11 aware, like OpenSSH or also Firefox, for example. And if you want to protect your SSL certificates, you might be interested in an open SSL engine that exists, which is called TPM2 TSS Engine. So there are existing compatibility bridges to use the TPM with existing programs that confirm certain standards. If you just want to play around with a TPM just to see what it can do, I'd recommend installing TPM2 tools. It's a set of command line applications, and basically every application just exposes one functionality of the TPM, so you can just play around with that. Read the man page, everything is documented quite nicely to see what a TPM can do. Before you do that, you want to add your user to the TSS user group, because by default the TPM is just available to root. So to get access as a normal user, because you don't want to run all these tools as root, add yourself to the TSS user group, log in, log out, log in again, and then you can get started. Okay, now for some practical demonstrations. First, I want to show you how to protect your SSH keys, the example I've already talked about, using your TPM. So we are going to use this PKCS11 bridge I've already talked about. And so you need to install the software, of course. As I said, you need to add yourself to the user group, and then you can get started with the example, which I'm going to show you now. So first, what we need to do is we need to initialize a store, because the TPM itself has only a very limited amount of memory. So what you do is, instead of storing all your keys in the TPM, you are storing them on disk, but protected with a key that is only available to the TPM. So it's just as secure as storing everything in the TPM, because you can't do anything with the on-disk files. So we need to initialize the store on disk and create this key that is only available in the TPM, which is called a primary key. And this command does this. Then, once we've got this, we need to add a token. So this comes from the PKCS11 standard. So think of a token as one of these smart cards. You can store multiple of these tokens in one TPM, so it doesn't make too much sense in the context of a TPM, but you can use, for example, different tokens for different purposes, like SSH keys, SSH host keys, OpenPGP keys, whatever. To add this token, we need to specify the ID of the primary key we just created. So this number is usually one. We give it a label so we know what it is for. We want to use it for SSH keys. And we also need to specify two kinds of passwords. The first is some kind of admin password, so you can use this one to, for example, if you forget the user password, you can reset it with this one, but usually you just use this user password here for everything else. So now we've got a token, we now can proceed to actually add one of these secret keys to it. So we've got TPM to P tool add key. We need to specify which token we're going to use, so we call that by label. Then we can give the key a name. So for example, if you're using different SSH keys for different hosts, you will probably put this here to identify which one is which. It's just a label. It isn't used for anything important. Then you've got the key algorithm. So in this case, we're using an elliptic curve algorithm with key strings of 256 bits. And again, we need to specify the pin we've just created. So now we've got the key. Now everything is set up. We just need to make sure now that SSH can actually work with this key. So we need to get the public part of the key, which we can do using SSH key gen with the DA argument, and then you specify the path to this library TPM to PKS11, which we are using with, which is this part, this path here. And this outputs the public part of the key. So now you can copy this to your system that you want to authenticate against. And once you've done this, you can now authenticate against the system using SSHI. Again, you need to specify the path to the library and of course the server that you want to authenticate against. So if you do this, you need to input the password you've just created, and as you can see, everything worked nicely, and you get also some kind of debugging output, so these warnings are not important, but for example, if you manage to mistype your password, it will tell you this as well, of course. If you want to authenticate against multiple systems, typing in your password every time you do SSH becomes old pretty quickly. So what you probably want to do is you want to add this key to your SSH agent, which is the standard way to manage multiple SSH keys. So you can do that as well using SSH add with the S argument. And again, you specify the path to the library, and then you should get this output. And if I do SSH a add L, you can see that the key has been added to the agent. Cool. So this is probably the easiest way to make your system more secure using a TPM. Just store your SSH keys there. Of course, remember to do backups. So if you're playing around with that, you don't want to have this as the only key because something might go wrong. But yeah, that's quite a nice way of making use of a TPM. So the next example, OpenPGP keys, I am gonna skip over a bit because I'm afraid I won't have enough time to show the actual example, but I have all the instructions on the slides, and the slides should be available on the conference page by now. So if you want to do that, you can look it up there in more detail. Unfortunately, using a TPM to manage your OpenPGP case is a bit more difficult because, well, one of the problems is that NewPG does not support PKCS11 tokens. It has its own kind of standard, but, well, that's a bit hard to work with. There is a branch to work with a TPM natively, which someone created a while ago. Unfortunately, it hasn't seen much development. I think the last commit was in 2018. So at the moment, it's a bit hard, but you can do it. There is a compatibility layer that connects PKCS11 tokens to NewPG, which is developed externally. The name can be found on the slide. The issue with that is that it only exists, it only supports existing keys that are already stored on the token, so you cannot migrate your keys that you already have to the token, but you have to create new ones there. So I don't recommend actually generating the whole key on the TPM, because if you lose your computer or reset your TPM, the keys will be gone, and this is not so great for PGP keys, of course. But what you can do is, if you have separate subkeys for every device to do signing, then you can store these signing keys on the TPM. So I think that's kind of a cool usage, but I wouldn't recommend storing the whole key there. And the other limitation, but that's, well, somebody would have to put in the work, but that would be doable, but it hasn't been done so far, is that this compatibility bridge I'm talking about only supports RSA keys. So if you want to have more modern elliptic curve cryptography keys, that is not possible at the moment. So yeah, as you can see on this slide, it's a bit annoying. I'm not gonna demo it, but this would be the setups. And again, you can find the slides on the conference page, so you can look it up there. So this is some, this should give you some idea what you can store in a TPM and how you can use it. The other thing I want to talk is, how can you use a TPM to secure your boot process? So the idea is, now if an attacker gets into your system, they won't be able to exfiltrate the actual keys, but they will still be able to do something with the TPM. Wouldn't it be nice if your TPM could just say, okay, something is wrong here, I don't give access to these keys because I sense that some attacker has compromised the system. And a TPM can do this. So it can grant access to your secrets only if the system is in a known good state. Well, what is a known good state? The root of trust in this case is your device's EFI firmware. So you have to trust your hardware vendor as usual. If you don't do that, you're already pretty lost. And what your EFI firmware does, it can measure certain configurations or system states into so-called platform configuration registers on your TPM. So every time a certain kind of event occurs, it measures this into your TPM, and you can then proceed to seal your secrets against these configurations. So only if the configuration matches, access to the secret will be granted. And well, what kinds of measurements are there available? There are different kind of platform configuration registers for different kind of events. I'm not going to talk about all of these, but only about the most important ones, or the ones you might be want to use for your own setup. So the most important PCR you always want to include in your measurements is PCR0, because it stores the hash of the EFI firmware. If you update your firmware or someone changes it somehow, that should make everything else invalid. So this is important to include. And then you've got PCR4, and PCR4 stores a hash of all the EFI binaries that have been executed in the boot process. So usually this is at least your bootloader, and probably also your kernel as well. And to be more secure, you should look into making a unified EFI bundle to store your kernel, the init RAM FS, and the kernel command line in one single EFI applications. How you can do that, you can look up in the Arch Wiki, because in this case, you measure everything in there. You can't change the init RAM FS anymore, for example, to put malicious binaries in there. So in this case, to make use of the TPM in its full potential, you want to do this. And the other interesting PCR you might want to be aware is PCR 7, because it stores the secure boot state. So secure boot is a way you can sign the binaries that are launched during the boot process, and only so the firmware only executes binaries that are signed by your trusted keys. And PCR 7 measures whether secure boot has been turned on or off, so that nobody modifies your BIOS configuration to just turn it off. And it also measures the certificates that have been used during boot. So if you're using your own keys, you will be sure that only your own keys have been used, not, for example, the Microsoft key to load something else if that is already stored in your EFI firmware by default. So what I'd recommend is, if you want to go that route, you either, if you're using secure boot with your own keys, you want to use at least PCRs 0 and 7. And if you're not using secure boot, you probably want to use PCRs 0 and 4, combined with always one of these unified kernel images. If you're using PCR 0 and 4, it means after every kernel or init RAMFS update, you will need to recalculate everything after an update. So you will have to reseal your secrets to the new values. So this can become a bit annoying. I'd recommend doing secure boot then, because then you only have to make sure that the signing keys match. So you can just use PCR 0 and 7. And okay, how do I do that now? How do I verify that my system has not been tampered with during boot? Well, the easiest way probably to do this is to use TMT TOTP, which I'm a co-maintainer of, as I said, as a full disclosure. TPM2 TOTP allows you to store a time-based one-time password, or TOTP, secret in your TPM, and it shows it every time you boot your system. So TOTPs you might be familiar with from two-factor authentication in the internet. So the idea is you store a secret on your phone and a secret on server, and you need to then input the secret as the TOTP you get shown on your phone, which changes every 30 seconds because it's derived from the secret stored there and the current time. You need to input this six-digit code to authenticate against the server. In this case, it's the other way around. Your system shows you this six-digit code, which changes every 30 seconds, and you can verify it with your phone to see whether the two match. And when you boot, you look up the code on your phone. If the two match, then you can be sure that your system configurations, or at least the part you measure, as I said, this depends on the PCRs you use, has not changed. And there are already hooks available for MK in its DPAO and Draykit, so this TOTP should get shown automatically during boot. And if you have Plymouth installed, it gets a bit more fancy, but usually it's just plain text output, which works as well, of course. So how do you do that? Yeah, of course, you need to install the actual software, and then I can demo that quickly as well for you. Let's clear that up. You just do TPM2 TOTP generate, and you specify the platform configuration registers you want to seal against. I'm using secure boot with my own keys, so I will be using 0 and 7 here, and generate a key. Let's make that a bit smaller. Now you get a QR code you can scan with your favorite TOTP applications on your phone, and then you can do TPM2 TOTP calculate. which should show you the six-digit code. Of course, this talk is pre-recorded, so by the time you're watching this, if you've scanned this code, this will not match anymore, which is fine, but if you do it yourself on your own system, the two should match now. Otherwise, the time is not correct on either your computer or laptop and on your phone. Great. And of course, you need, if you're using mkinitcpao, you need to add TPM2 TOTP to your hooks. So you would then edit etsy mkinitcpao.conf and put the TPM2 TOTP hook in your hooks variable. Do it before your encrypt hook, because otherwise you won't be able to see it in time. So do it as early as possible. And then during boot, it will look something like this. This is if you've got Plymouth installed to have a nice graphical boot. I don't usually do this. It's on the AUR. So if you're not using Plymouth, it will be just a plain text hook. It will not look as exciting as this, but it will also show the current time and the six-digit TOTP secret. So this is great if you have interactive access to your system and can actually verify this code. If you have a remote server, it might not be possible to check this code every time before you input your disk encryption keys. So what you would want to do for remote servers is you would want to store the disk encryption key in the TPM and store it against a known good system configuration. So if that doesn't match anymore, it won't input the key and won't boot your system essentially. So you have to come fix that because someone has tampered with your system somehow. And if everything matches, it just basically inputs the key automatically and boots up without your user input. So this is basically what BitLocker does in the Windows world, because it uses it stores the key in the TPM. On Linux, that's a bit more annoying at the moment, but will hopefully get better quite soon, because now there is not a very standard solution that I'm aware of. The one that probably comes close is Clevis. It's also packaged in the official Arch Linux repositories. There are Draket hooks available for it, so if you're using Draket, you can use it pretty much out of the box for mkinitcpao. Unfortunately, there is no such support at the moment. But if you want to look into this at the moment, I recommend Clevis. But fortunately, it will get better pretty soon, because native support for storing the secret in the TPM is planned for Crypt Setup 2.4. So that's why I'm not going to show a demo today, because hopefully the next version of Crypt Setup will have that already set up for you and you can just use it out of the box. And I'm very excited for this. So hopefully in another year's time, we can come back and I can just show you that, and it's going to be real easy. So hopefully I've given you some ideas about how you can use a TPM and why it's nice to store secrets there instead of storing them directly on disk. I've also briefly touched the subject how you can verify the integrity of your system using these platform configuration registers. As a last word of warning, please always do backups, of course, because you don't want to rely only on the TPM. If you manage to clear it by accident or something goes wrong with the software, you don't want to lose all your disk encryption keys or your PGP keys. So please always do at least one backup on some encrypted hard drive somewhere else where you store all your important data. But so if you're interested in this topic, of course, there's this Q&A session starting now on the conference IRC channel. So I welcome any questions there. If you want to know how to get started, for example, contributing to the software yourself, or there are also some more tutorials available, a good overview which software already has TPM support and how you can achieve it, you can look at our webpage, which is shown here. There's also, if you have any further questions, there's a mailing list and a Gitter chat, so ways to get in touch quickly. And yeah, thank you very much for listening to my talk, and I welcome any questions you might have now.
Hello, I'm Luna, and we have some questions for Jonas about this talk about TPMs. And the first question is from Jonathan. What's the advantage of using TPM for storing keys as opposed to be storing keys on an encrypted disk?
Well, if you're storing your keys on an encrypted disk, the keys are secure as long as the disk is encrypted, for sure. But as soon as you unlock the system, so if an attacker is inside your actual live system, then the keys are not protected anymore because the attacker can have access to everything that's stored on disk because it's decrypted then. So the idea is, even if your system is compromised, if you store them in a TPM, the attacker can't get to the actual secret. They might be able to use the TPM, but as soon as you switch off your computer, you know nobody's doing any bad stuff with your keys because they are never exposed to your main operating system.
An Arch guest had a question that was almost the same. Is it possible to use TPM to store disk encryption keys?
So that was the last part of the talk. I apologize for not going into detail there, because it's just because I believe that the native support that CryptoTab will hopefully gain pretty soon will be much easier to set up. So I didn't want to go into detail. You have a couple of options now. You can write your own mkinit cpao or draket hooks, or you can use the ones that are pre-built, for example, ones from Clevis for draket. But at the moment, that's a bit complicated to set up. So hopefully the next version of Crypt Setup will make that all very easy.
Then we have a question from Yay4N, Yon, however it should be pronounced. Can you do secure boot with TPM? Also, can it be prevented from being rewritten by Arch ISO on a USB?
So secure boot and TPM are somewhat complementary. So you can use both at the same time. And in this case, a TPM can, for example, be used to store your disk encryption keys and only release them if your secure boot setup hasn't changed. So what you do is you verify using secure boot that your EFI binaries have not been tampered with, and then the TPM guarantees that only the secure boot keys that you are using, so probably your own keys, not the ones from, for example, from your distribution or Microsoft, have been used, but only your own keys. And well, if you boot Arch ISO, usually you don't have that one signed with your own keys, so it wouldn't boot using secure boot. And if you turn off secure boot, then the TPM won't return your keys because your configuration has changed. So you would have to sign your Arch ISO with your secure boot keys, and in that case, I'd assume that's actually what you want to run.
And then we have a question from Hexchain. It seems to me that trusted boot overlays with secure boots in some ways, does it?
So secure boot is basically just guaranteeing that your system only executes trusted binaries. You can do that with a TPM, so trusted boot, without using Secure Boot, but it's not so convenient because then every time you, for example, update your kernel, your binaries change that you run during boot, and so you the system state, these PCRs I was talking about, change as well, and therefore it's quite nice having this combination of Secure Boot and a TPM, but you don't have to do it. You can use Secure Boot without TPM, of course, and you don't necessarily need a Secure Boot while running a TPM to secure your boot up. It's just a bit more convenient, in my opinion.
Lars asked the next question. Do you not actually need to type a fast passphrase on boot time if you have set it up with TPM?
That's something you can configure yourself. So personally, my setup requires typing a passphrase as well as storing part of the disk encryption key in the TPM. So you have to have both. For example, if you have a remote server, you probably don't want to type in a passphrase. And this next version of Crypt Setup should also make this possible, either just to store the disk encryption key in full in the TPM, or to secure it with an additional passphrase. So that's basically what you get in the Windows world with BitLocker at the moment already, because there you can either choose to just unlock the system automatically or require a second PIN to be typed in addition to the protection that the TPM offers to the disk encryption key.
And then Rizferry 111 has the next question. How does TOTP actually derive a code from the key and time? Is it something as simple as hash key plus time?
Yeah, basically. So it's an HMAC algorithm, which is, as you said, basically just a hash derived from a secret, which is stored in the TPM, and the current time. And the nice thing is that the TPM can actually do this HMAC calculation itself. So in the previous version of the specification, this was not possible. But now you don't actually need to release this key anymore at all to the operating system, because just the whole HMAC operation is done in the TPM. You just have to fed it the current time that still comes from the system, so it's potentially untrusted. That's maybe some kind of attack vector, but the TPM doesn't have a real-time clock, so this part is not secure, but the secret part of the HMAC is stored in the TPM and never released.
From Grassolini. Nice talk, Jonas, but how do you account for time difference between your phone's clock and your computer's clock? Sometimes TPM2 TOTP output will take more than 30 seconds to display the right token.
So the hooks actually display the TOTP after 30 seconds have passed. So once as fast as it can be done, and then every 30 seconds, after every full 30 seconds have passed. Of course, if your system clock and, for example, smartphone clock don't match, then you're gonna have a problem, but at least you can detect that pretty easily, because if you're not using Plymouth, that is, but just the plain text version, you get the current time, the current system time of your laptop or computer or whatever, so you can at least see where it's going wrong. Of course, again, the system time is not something trusted, so one possible attack vector is that somebody messes around with your system clock and just pre-generates a lot of these TOTP values, so that's something to keep in mind. But that's not an attack vector we are currently including in our threat model.
And then the last question we have time for is from Sirak. Was there any research into the physical security of TPMs? Would stealing a TPM mean stealing the keys inside?
So if somebody gains physical access to your TPM, I wouldn't be entirely confident that they couldn't extract it. So of course, that's again not really part of the threat model, but yes, if you gain physical access to the TPM, probably you can with some kind of microscope and everything get out the keys somehow. So I think there has been some research. I'm not an expert on that at all, but yeah, I think this is definitely a possibility. Yeah.
And that was the questions we had time for. Next up is the lightning talks after the break.